whole thing started basically 50 years ago when I started finding things as a child walking around the fields, but 2012 was the crowning moment. In 2012 we ploughed a field which we now call the kiln field, and a strange piece of pottery turned up, and I had no idea what it was, but it just didn't look right to me to be a bit of pot or whatever. Took it to the Castle Museum and they said, looks like it could be a piece of kiln fabric. And have you found pottery? I said, yes, I found Roman pottery. Well, you might have a Roman pottery kiln. Very unlikely, but it's worth, you know, thinking about that. That's when we decided to get Britannia Archaeology involved, and they came and did some geophysicking, and that maps what's underneath the surface of the soil without actually having to dig a hole. So you get an idea of what's underneath. An idea.
So geophysical survey is a means by which we scan the ground, we run a survey over an area of potential, and that will bring up any anomalies that are in the ground, archaeological, geological, potentially modern.
So we had a little trial trench scraped back the surface, and about 40 centimetres under the surface we found the top of a Roman pottery kiln. And that was the beginning of it, really.
The area where the kilns are produced nearly 30,000 finds in a 12 metre by 12 metre area. They are some of the best preserved kilns that I've seen, certainly that others have seen as well. Because they are being investigated as part of a community and research project, it allows us the opportunity to go into far more detail than we may normally be allowed through development archaeology. When we've selected the areas that we're going to excavate our trenches in, we bring the machine in, and the first thing we need to do is take the topsoil off carefully so that we can, you know, really get the trench set out. We then take it down in spits, layer by layer, piece by piece, and as the machine bucket is taking that back, I'll be checking to see if there's any changes in the density of the soil, the makeup of the soil, and if there are any clear archaeological features coming through. So you really have to watch and make sure, because of course if he comes back and takes another slice, it's gone. The first thing we do, even though the machine bucket has already partially cleaned the trench, everybody trowels back and we just take off a couple of centimetres to define that archaeology. And that's why they're doing it with trousers, so they can really define the profile of that. Because if we just have a spade, you're just going to cut it and it'll probably be a box. Whereas we actually want to see the shape of the feature that was dug 2,000 years ago, that was then filled in. Someone's now going to dig it out again.
But everywhere we look, there's something. And it's a huge site. It's very rare to have a site where you can access almost all parts of it, and it's going to give a great picture of the whole landscape, not just the Roman landscape, but the whole landscape over the last X thousand years. We think we've got a fairly substantial building in and around the kitchen garden area, a farmhouse basically. So we've got Romanized Britons who are trading with the Romans, probably raising cattle, other stock, growing crops, and paying their taxes as they had to. That's the whole point of the whole Roman occupations, pay taxes and mine things. I believe we had a big farming situation going on, so there'll be slaves working the fields. The house was going to be occupied by the boss man and his family. We know we've got underfloor heating system. We know we've got painted wall plaster, so it's quite a high status. The chap who built this had a few denarii, basically. He's probably living in his roundhouse with his thatched roof, his rather smelly fire, and his friend up the road at Marsham, there we know there's a villa at Marsham, probably had this beautiful villa built, and he thought, well, hang on a minute, I want a bit of that.
We go through every square foot of the soil here. It's all sieved, or as much of it is sieved as we can in the 2 weeks that we have this open. And that's because through all of the excavations here and through the work that Peter has done here, there is a vast amount of information held in the subsoil. So that's the soil building up to the topsoil here, above the level that we're on. And normally on archaeological excavations, you only ever see a set sample of that. Again, we're not restricted by normal development timescales, so we can really look at that. And the information that we get from that is invaluable, because we can really see where there is intense areas of activity, where you're getting to the peripheral areas of activity, which is what we're looking at here, but also you can get ideas for the type of activity. So for example, we have found areas where there is metalworking waste. So we now get into, well, okay, we might be looking at having a bloomery or something nearby. You may have noticed the circle on the ground. Now this is a potential feature that we have to look at. As this is an evaluation, we check everything because the geophysics isn't perfect. It will only pick up certain types of features. And this is something where we've cleaned back. It's clearly visible that there's a change in the colours of the soil. We need to basically put a slot in there to investigate whether that is natural in origin or man-made. And if it is man-made, if we can get some dating evidence out of it to actually work out what period that comes from. And that's essentially what we do throughout the trench.
In the top of one of the kilns, there's been a patch up, a repair job, and some clay has been put obviously where there was a hole, and you can see the guy's fingerprints, whoever did put it in, or lady, but you can see the fingerprints of this chap from what 1,800 years ago are literally set in stone, and you can see these fingerprints and you can touch the person who did it, if that makes sense. That sounds a bit romantic, but I love the fact that that's what happens. The other thing about clay tiles such as this one here, they're made and they're laid out to dry, and when they're laid out to dry, animals walk over them and you get footprints of different animals, and we have got a huge range of footprints.
So we know we have potters here and they are extracting local clays to make the pottery, which they're then firing in the kilns, so it's not impossible to believe that they are also extracting other clays to use to make building materials to construct their building. So what they would do is, after they have formed the tile and the pot, they would leave these out to dry, to air dry for a while before they actually go into the kiln themselves, and once everyone's gone away, you're going to get some wildlife that's going to come in and they're going to crawl all over those lower tiles that are further down.
One of the things that I did as a child was tracking animals. I grew up on a farm and went out tracking with my father, and you're applying the same skills to the wet clay, and we've got some lovely examples here. We've got toe prints showing. This is just a partial print, because when the animals are running and moving, they're just bounding along on the tiles and just leaving tiny marks, sometimes only the toe marks. But it's leaving wonderful evidence. So far, we've got around 20 species that have been found here.
It's all very well. I happen to own some land which is, well, sitting over 40 acres of archaeology, and I had this wonderful plan to have a community dig, but without the people coming to do it, it would never have happened. And they are absolutely wonderful. They turn up day after day after day, getting into holes, getting grubby, finding virtually nothing sometimes, and all the enthusiasm. And it's what it's all about. It's what makes the whole thing work. And it's, if it wasn't for these people, it wouldn't be here.
This project is amazing. It's got a wonderful team of people, one of the most enthusiastic landowners that's very interested in the archaeology. We've got the luxury of time, which as a commercial archaeologist I don't always have. One of my personal exciting finds has been a dog from here, which has a very distinctive skull. And that's enabled me to identify the breed down to a Scandinavian breed of dog. This is the only one that I know of in this country of this particular breed. That's exciting in itself, but this dog was also found with another very unusual find, which is a beaver tooth amulet, and that was found associated with the dog burial. Normally these are only associated with human burials. We're not sure who the dog belonged to. It could be associated with the potter. The dog was found in a pit that was associated with the kilns, and there was rubbish from the kilns, so chances are it was associated with him. And that would make sense because people were brought in from all over the Roman Empire at this time, with the demand for the need to build all these new villas, and they had to get the skilled labour to come in from all over the world. Last week we discovered a pot in situ. Henry lifted this as a soil block, brought it into the finds tent so we can very carefully excavate it, recording with photographs and drawings as we go, numbering each of the pieces of pottery. There could be a cremation in here. It could be a votive offering or just food as well that's been disposed of. You can see Henry here is just removing soil for samples. He will do that, bagging up each sample separately. That can be sieved separately for tiny finds. Taking very tiny samples like this and numbering them, we've got a sequence of events of what's happening in this block.
This all began through years and years and years of picking up bits and pieces out of molehills. And a lot of help from a lot of people, Dr. John Davis from the Cast Museum, and obviously from Britannia themselves. And we ended up with a community dig, and I thought, well, yeah, we'll have a dig one year and that'll be it. So 2 weeks digging, we found our two Roman pottery kilns and thousands of bits of pottery. And there we are 5 years later, and I've got probably 50 years ahead of me. Well, I haven't, so I'll be very dead. But those 50 years, I should think, of archaeology. We've got a 40-acre site.
We don't normally get a chance to look at a historic landscape in this much detail.
Every bit of work here is done to a very high professional level, but we've got the luxury of time for studying these finds.
Morning. Without the people coming to do it, it would never have happened, and they are absolutely wonderful.
You may think this is sad, but 90% of the time you will find me with a trout, simply because the other 10% of the time I'm looking for it.